who are in Pakistan, good morning for us and for friends from US. Good evening, or for some, it's midnight almost. Very welcome to this webinar series. Today we have a speaker from the National Center of Excellence in Geology, University of Peshawar, Professor Dr. Samina Siddiqui. We'll be talking about petroleum systems in the Himalayan foothills, Pakistan, oil production and cleanup techniques. So we are looking forward, and I'll now ask Bob to introduce the speaker and take over the program. Bob, over to you, please.
Yes, thank you, Irfan, and again, welcome to everybody, and thank you for joining us from different parts of the world. Before we get started this evening, or this morning in Pakistan, I just want to remind us, our next speaker coming up next week is going to be Jason Head from Cambridge University in the UK, and he's going to be speaking about the reptilian fossils in the Shuraliks. And then, keeping with the paleontology theme, the following week, we've got Parth Chauhan from the India Institute of Science Education and Research in Chandigarh, and he'll be talking about the hominid fossils, the quest for hominid fossils in the Shuraliks. So we've got two exciting talks coming up on paleontology, and after that, we have Lisa Talks, who will talk about magnetics, Peter Zeitler will talk about sediment provenance, and we've got a variety of other speakers coming, so please do stay tuned and join us in these future presentations. Today, it's our wonderful pleasure to welcome Dr. Samina Siddiqui, who comes to us from Peshawar. She obtained her PhD from the University of Wales in Aberystwyth, and she studies soil science and the distribution of different soil types in Northern Pakistan, and she's been looking at hydrocarbon systems and remediating hydrocarbon spills. And it's a wonderful opportunity to branch out into soil sciences. And I think somebody needs to mute. If somebody's got some background, please do mute your sound. But we've got an opportunity really to hear from the point of view of the active surface, the soil science, that is so important, both in terms of the modern setting and, of course, preserved in the rock record. And one of the wonderful things about the Shuraliks is that the soils are documented, and we actually have heard several speakers, Catherine Badgley, Kay Berensmeyer, and I think Gary Johnson also mentioned the characteristic soils in the Shuraliks. So, and those are paleosols, or old soils. But we understand the old soils by studying the modern soils. So I'm going to turn the floor over to Dr. Siddiqui, and she will give her presentation. So welcome, Samina.
Thank you very much, Professor Bob and your team, for giving me an opportunity to present my work. The title of my presentation is Petroleum Systems in the Himalayan Foothills, Pakistan, Oil Production and Cleanup Techniques. I am grateful to Dr. Irfanullah Jan and also my students, Ms. Shehla and Mr. Asim Shahzad, who helped me in executing the project for the second part of this presentation. Now, this presentation has been divided into two parts. First part is the review of the Himalaya orogeny and total petroleum system in Pakistan. Pakistan has two dominant petroleum systems, which is Patala Nambal Composite Total Petroleum System and Semper Group Ghazji Composite Petroleum System. And some light, I will put some light on the stratigraphy of these total petroleum system and how can these total petroleum system or the hydrocarbon generated from these systems can be become as environmental hazard, and how these environmental hazard can be remediated using some economic, low cost and environmental friendly techniques, which is bioremediation. Now, this is the map, tectonic map of Himalaya orogeny adopted from Craig 2018 in his review. Himalaya orogeny, as you all know, is the has been being 250 to 350 kilometer wide and is stretched nearly 2,400 kilometer. between the Nanga Parbat Sentex to the northwest in Pakistan and the Namcha Burma Sentex in the southeast in Tibet, and it branches eastward towards the India westward it branches to the Sulaiman Kirthar fold beds in Pakistan, and eastward to the Indo-Burma ranges in the eastern Indian Bangladesh. So this petroleum system, this Himalaya orogeny remained an interesting area for the petroleum geologists because of its tectono-sedimentary basins and some stratigraphy setting, oil and gas pockets, source rocks and reservoir rocks, and it has been explored worldwide, even in Pakistan. And we can see here in this map, the sub-Himalayan region, which is Potohar-Pohat region, is the hydrocarbon-prone area, which has been explored over the last several years for hydrocarbon generation. Now, the sediments are, as you all know, being a geologist, that the thick sediments are of marine, deltic, lacustrine, or terrestrial type. When we are going to design our degradation project or bioremediation project, once the oil or hydrocarbon is spilled over the terrestrial land, because I'm focusing on the impact, environmental impact of terrestrial land of this oil, then this the type of this sedimentation is very important, because these sediments, whether they are derived from marine type, or they are deltic type, lacustrine or terrestrial, they are the good source of the organic matter. The organic matter is usually derived from C3 and C4 plants, which I am going to discuss in my next slides. So that these thick sediments, which are marine or deltic or both or terrestrial marine sediments in Kohat-Potohar basin of greater than 5,000 meter of infra-Cambrian, Neo-Protozoic to early Cambrian to Eocene age, with a major break in deposition between the Ordovician and the Carboniferous. The Potohar petroleum system is classic evaporates of lower Cambrian, marine and deltic shales of Jurassic, Triassic and Permian, marine shales of Paleocene, the shallow marine shales of the Eocene Patala formation ranging in thickness from 20 to 180 meter and are the predominant oil source. If we look at these four types of these clastic evaporates or lower Cambrian sedimentation, then we are here clearly it's indicate that shales are the most probable sediments found which are oil prone. So if these shales, when has been explored, when oil drilling or rigging is going on and these shales are being explored for this petroleum hydrocarbon generation, and of course the waste is generated, so the type of the waste will have shales, mostly shale in nature, and the oil which is generated, if their depositional environment or the sedimentary type is marine, then of course it will have different type of hydrocarbons present in it than the terrestrial, and that will affect the rate of degradation and the designing of the experiment for bioremediation of this type of crude oil or the oily sludge which is generated from during oil exploration. So this is the main focus. That's why I have given these slides. I don't want to give you more detail because most of you will know about it. So these thick sediments, when we are going to look at the sediment type, which I've discussed already, marine and lacustrine, that of course, they are a very good organic matter source. If it's C3, which is derived from algal lipids and nitrogenous compounds, then the N-alkanes petroleum compounds, which is composed of N-alkanes, paraffin, aromatics, naphthalene, saturated, unsaturated hydrocarbons. So the source of these organic matters, algal. So it means that if we are going to design some of the experiment, we have to design for those microbes which are capable of degrading these type of hydrocarbons. It's not only that straight chain hydrocarbons are present in petroleum compounds, but they are longer chain length hydrocarbons, some acyclic isopropanoids, pristine phytane, and some, of course, aromatic compounds which are present, but may be present in traces. Some of these hydrocarbons are easily degradable, some are severely degradable, some are rapidly degradable, some are medium degradable. So those alkanes which are with the carbon chain length of C25 to C37, these are plant waxes which are derived from cellulose and lignin over a longer period of time. Of course, there are depositional environment, suitability of temperature, presence of oxygen taken by the anaerobic microorganism which are present in the deep reservoir, and they take it from the sulfate rock, oxygen, or from nitrate which is present, or carbonate, and then they do the process, and slowly or gradually these are converted into these carbon chain which can be in the form of an alkane or in the aromatic. I'm not given that this table is very long, so only few of the type of carbon chain length has been presented here, and just only give you an idea about what are the organic matter source and what are the sedimentation and the carbon chain length and how we are going to degrade when these are spilled over the terrestrial surface. Now, this is the biodegradation which is adopted from Wenger to 2012. And here you can see that the alkanes which are derived from, depending on the chain length, this chain length can be shorter. It started from C10 to C20, C30, and it can be N-paraffins which range up to C44. So here in this table, on our right side, we can see that these are studied from medium to high biodegradable rate. It means that the chain length, and straight chain length, even straight chain length, if they are having greater carbon number and chain length increases, then their biodegradation rate scale is also increasing. So they are difficult to degrade even by the microorganism that we are using. So we have to have special those microorganisms which are used as a remediation technique to degrade these longer chain, including with other carbon chain, which can be alkyl cyclohexane. If we look at the alkyl cyclohexane, then this is hexane group, and you can see that the number here given is 4. It means that they are nearly to severely degradable or very less degradable, or they need more time or to degrade naturally. But natural degradation of this compound is very slow process. That's why remediation techniques has been recommended to speed up the process, so that the time scale for degrading natural degradation can be accelerated. Isopropanoids are branch chain. These can be pristine phytane, even farnesene, non-farnesene, non-pristine, and these are also severely degradable, because one or the other thing is, then the straight chain length increases, the rate of degradation increases. Isopropanoid, if the branches are increases within a petroleum compound, then the degradation rate increases. Similarly, if we have a look to the hopens, which are the biomarker and which are used for the developing establishing the relationship between soil and source rock and oil, then these, you can see that these are severely degradable. So these are 7 or 8, and even hopens are reaching to 9. So they are very severely, although they are present in very minute quantity, but they are severely degradable compound, and they may be toxic when present over a long period of time. Similarly, if I look to the aromatic are benzene ring. Here I'm just showing only the naphthalenes. Naphthalene has 6 benzene ring, and then dimethyl, methyl, their rate of degradation you can see is 5, which means that they are nearly to severe. But when tetramethyl, depending on the branches attached to the benzene group, increases, then the degradation rate also increases. So these are some of these compounds which are present in the petroleum compound, whether it's a crude oil or oily sludge, which has been explored from underneath the surface and then dumped over the surface and then become an environmental hazard. Now, Himalaya orogeny and total petroleum system, there are two dominant petroleum system, Patala Namal composite system, which is Kohat Potohar, which is the hydrocarbon prone area, where is Sambar Guru or Ghazji composite system, Indus and Salman Kirthar geological province, which is the gas prone area. There are some oil wells in Hyderabad and Badin area, but it is dominated by the gas generation pockets, and where Kohat Potohar province or Kohat Potohar plateau is mainly generating crude oil. Neshpa is one of the most productive crude oil well, which is in Kohat. Now here you can see this is also the map which is adopted from Craig. He has a very good review about the petroleum system in Himalaya orogeny. So these are, we can have a look to the Potohar and Kohat geological province, which is hydrocarbon prone area. Here is the list of so many oil wells has been drilled and still search for new oil wells. Some of them have been abandoned and some of them still search for new oil wells has been on its way. And sub-Himalayan is the geology which is underneath this Potohar-Kohat plateau. Now this map is showing the generalized oil wells which is in Potohar and Kohat areas, and Patan and Namala is the hydrocarbon generation system. First oil well was digged in 1866 in Kunder, and then first commercial discovery was made in 1915 in Khor, Potohar region. Quite a number of oil wells has been drilled. Khor is that they have different formation, and of course the reservoir differs from oil well to oil well. And Skesar and Murray formation are the reservoir for Khor, and it will be different for if I are going to talk about Toot or Dulian or the Dakni or Fim Kasar. They have different reservoir rock where oil has been trapped. So still today there are several oil well exploration is going on, and some of them have been become abundant. Now this is some of the work of my student, which is unpublished data. We have taken the samples from Patala, Chijali and Datta formation underneath these, of course from the OGDCL we requested. And the total organic carbon S1 and rock wall analysis and has been performed. And this is giving an overview about the TOC and Patala, Chijali and Datta formation. We know that Datta is one of the reservoir in Kohat area. And Patala is also that formation which is hydrocarbon prone reservoir in this North Potohar area. Sorry, second is the Sambar Guru Ghazji hydrocarbon generation system. It includes the lower and middle and upper part of the upper Indus basin, and include the southwestern Kohat plateau and much of the Salman Kirthar geological province. The area of the total petroleum system is characterized by the relatively flat floodplain of the Indus Basin to the east and uplifted and folded mountainous areas of Potohar, Kohat, Surghar, Suleiman and Kirthar on the north and west of these areas. Sweep is the, as I have already told you, that this is mostly the gas prone area, although some of the oil wells are also there, have been explored. And the sweet gas field in the Salman Kirthar fold and John Kirthar was the first discovery outside the Kohat Potohar plateau. And it was discovered in 1950s, Poch 1955, Mali gas 1957, Zoo gas 1954. If we have a look here on the legend, then it is showing that the neogene sedimentary rocks are mostly the sedimentary rocks or the generalized geology of these area where this has been explored for oil and gas production. Now here these are the upper, what are the stratigraphy of these Sambar Guru upper Indus Basin is lower Indus Basin, middle and upper, and Shivalik is one of the recent, top leading the formation, then followed by Rawalpindi, and showing some of the oil seep or oil pockets there. And then the most oil pockets which we have found in is of siltstone and sandstone in nature. And so when the kerogen type is kerogen type 3, it is mostly gas prone area, not the oil prone area. And some of the oil pockets are also there. So if we look at the stratigraphy of Kohat Potohar Plateau and also this Simber Grove Potohar, we can see that mostly the sandstone, as far as I can see from the stratigraphy, and the shale are the particle size, or we can say the we call it the texture of those reservoirs. So once these sandstone, and of course with the mud which they are using for drilling, when it is dumped over the surface, then it means that it's not only the crude oil that has been dumped, it is including some of these most of the reservoir rock, including with the mud that they are using for drilling, whether it's potassium or other mud, and then crude oil characteristics too. And the environment, my sediment types, if it's marine sediment, then we know that what type of if let's suppose if shale is or is marine sediment, and the organic matter type is C4, then the type of compounds which we'll found in petroleum and crude oil will range from NLK and more, and less aromatic compounds will be present in it. And this is in Pakistan what we are we have studied, that the crude oil or the oily sludge produced or dumped, it's mostly alkaline in nature, and aromatics are present, but they are present in traces. So the greater portion of the oil is alkaline, and the viscosity of course differ. Viscosity of course of also depend on the kerogen or bitumen type. Most of the geologists know that. I don't need to talk about that more. So this also affect our rate of biodegradation, and designing an experiment to degrade this completely over a short period of time. Now, this work, I am grateful to Dr. Irfan for his geological, for his support for geology in this executing this project, which is funded by HSC, and my two students. These are my student Asim Shehzad and Shaila, who had their PhD, and these are some of the sites which are environmental hazards, and these are the in the oil field site, these oily waste sludge which has been drilled from the oil during oil exploration and dumped in an open pit. Although this there are some protective measurement has been taken, but it's still there are long way to go to remediate these sites. There are several incidents happen all around the world. In Pakistan, several incidents, one of the most important incident which was happened in 2013, ferry which has spilled a large of oil and it has causes severe damages, and still now there are oil globules in the beach. We can find that because of less degradation rate of these, and perhaps the technology is not advanced enough that it can remediate it immediately, these, whether it's marine spill or terrestrial. I'm talking about the surface degradation. Subsurface degradation will involve very costly, and subsurface degradation involves some of the excavation and some of the other physical techniques which has not been, I suppose, applied here in Pakistan. So what are the environmental effect of this oil spill? Whether it is accidentally spilled because or it's leakage of pipeline rupture, or it has been dumped during oil exploration over the surface. These all are the environmental hazard. Why these are called an environmental hazard? It is more likely because these are composed of those compounds which are toxic and phytotoxic, and when it seeps down into the beneath the surface, terrestrial surface, then it can float over the groundwater, and then from one area to another area, it can contaminate the rivers, and of course then the sea, when waterfalls, river waters fall into the sea. So it means that there is chain connection of these spill from one side, and then we can have the effect for very far away of these oil spills. Similarly, if an agriculture land is become contaminated because of these oil spills, then it's very difficult to reclaim this or remediate that soil. And of course, the soil, what happens to the soil? Soil get sterile, its health and fertility is affected. Microbes, which are indigenous microbes present, very important for performing different action like nitrogen nitrification, denitrification, for carbon cycling. These all carbon cycle is disturbed. So it is very important to remediate these sites, and lots of people are working on this, how to remediate these contaminated site rapidly using economic, environmental friendly technique that has not have any environmental hazards. These are some of the glimpses of the oil site at Potohar and Kohat Plateau, where the samples have been taken. The project was designed to develop a microbial formulation and then apply this microbial formulation to degrade petroleum hydrocarbons which are present in the oil spill at laboratory scale under controlled temperature, and some of the nutrient which we have given, so that the biostimulation of these can be occur rapidly. So we wanted to find out what will have going to happen to these oil, what type of compounds are present in it, and how we are going to, which type of microbes we are going to have use, and how, which type of microbial formulation we are going to prepare to degrade these hydrocarbons over a short period of time. You can see this is some of the glimpses, that this is the leakage from the oil well site or dumping site. So you can see here soil is such a thick, it is covered with oil, and then you cannot even grow, even cannot walk. All the soil is made up of clay, silt and sand. The pore spaces is filled. There is no oxygen, and anoxic condition are created. Microbial activity is stopped or retarded, inhibited, and you cannot even germinate any crop. If we leave this, it will take years and years, and maybe it will never degrade, because the rate of degradation is extremely slow naturally. So here you can have a look when oil spill, depending on the oil viscosity, but oil field site, all the oils are very viscous and highly viscous. So their downwind penetration is, vertical penetration is slow, then the lateral penetration horizontally, it can cover the soil surface. If it covers the soil surface, then underneath the surface, the activities will not happen, which is happening in the under normal conditions in the uncontaminated soil profile. So we have selected some of the oil sites, Misa Kaswal, Kal, Satkal, and sample has been taken from all over Potohar Plateau, and these samples were brought to the laboratory. The scheme of study that we followed is the is that experimental design which we performed here is that we have taken the oil sludge sample and placed in the zipper bag, brought it to the laboratory, and then we of course dry it, and then we extract it through Soccolette extraction, and then we run it through GCMS. Firstly, we separate these different groups of hydrocarbons through silica gel column, and then that liquid form was run over GCFID or GCMS, and then we would know about the type of hydrocarbon present in it. So it's not only the microbe, we have also used the plant, and the isolation of microbes and screening of microbes also take place, and then microbes have been isolated using their protocol, microbial isolation, and then streaking plate techniques are used to streak that, and then the streaking, several times streaking has been carried out in order to isolate only one single colony, and then DNA extraction has been done and PCR sequences, 16S RNA sequences has been done, and the genera of the microbes were identified, and then these genera of microbes were individually being tested, their efficiency to degrade these petroleum hydrocarbons which we found in our sample. So if we have a look here, then the soil has A horizon, which is 0 to 15 centimeter thick, and the B horizon is below 15 to 30 centimeter. And the GCFID chromatogram here is showing a range of hydrocarbons, alkanes. Here, the longer peaks are showing the alkane, which start from C10 to C30. And here we can see these are the aromatic or isopronides present in it. And C17 and C18 are here. This one and this here is the phytane and pristane and C17 and phytane and C18, which are their emerging time is same. They emerge C17 emerge with with pristane, and C18 emerge with phytane. So they are the same. More or less same time of emergence. So this is the GCFID of the B horizon. These alkanes which I'm showing here, the slowly and gradually, the mid-chain alkanes, and then there are longer chain alkanes. These shorter chain alkanes are very toxic, and they are rapidly degraded. Toxic for the plants to grow, toxic for the microorganism, inhibit and affect the soil health. The type of microorganisms that we have found or isolated using microbial protocol and DNA hybridization is quite a number. 18 number of strain or 19 number of strain has been isolated only by one of my student, Ms. Shaila. And we have found that the Bacillus is the genera, and the Bacillus pumilus exicobacterium was the only type of genera which we have isolated, and their potential have not been yet tested for bioremediation, and very rare previous literature has been available. So we made a consortium with a number of these microbes. Those efficiency has been tested in the laboratory, whether they are being able to degrade the hydrocarbon in harmony or not. Otherwise, we will not be. If one bacteria genera or strain inhibit other bacteria or pathogenic to that bacteria, we cannot use it. So they were living in close coordination. That's why we have selected these bacteria, which I'm going to show later. What happened to microbes is that microbes play a very important role in degradation or in in normal routine life. Microbe has there is no microbe, there will be no life in soil. So there is a lake phase when any contamination, particularly with reference to oil, there is a lake phase. That lake phase can be for years if it has been remains as such without any remediation techniques adopted or the practices adopted. This lake phase can be a day, can be 2 days, depending upon the viscosity of the oil and also the quantity of the oil. And if it is being dumped continuously in the same area, then of course the lake phase is very high. These microbes, which I have shown that they have been isolated from hydrocarbon contaminated soil, some of them are also present in uncontaminated soil because these are indigenous microorganisms. They go into dormant state and they are inactive. That's why the degradation rate is very slow or sometimes inhibited, because these microbes are not in action because of lack of oxygen, lack of nutrient once oil is spilled on the surface. So main focus was how to reduce this lake phase and which type of microbes we have to use. This is the phylogenetic tree, because once we isolate microbes, we have to register it. So we can say that they have given the succession number, and which is succession number has been given to those microbes which I have shown you earlier in the slide. Now when we have take the extract Soccolette extract of these oily sludge, which has taken from Kohat Potong Har, and analyzed through GCMS, we have found that it contained carbon rate started from C13 to C16, and non-fluorescence and pristane and phytane. C34 is the longest chain carbon chain which we find, and the concentration varies. Of course, concentration varies, and their concentration is also calculated through GCMS chromatogram. Even with GCFID, we are using some of the techniques to calculate the quantitative analysis of these compounds which are present using the formula. Now, if we can see here, the deep Chandra deep, mostly we can see that the short chain hydrocarbon and C13, 2 and 16 are present in less quantity compared to C19 to C29. So, it means that most of the oily sludge are dominated by the middle chain hydrocarbons. And middle chain hydrocarbons are less toxic, and they can remain and persist for a longer time, and they are slow to degrade, as I have shown you in my degradation chart earlier in my presentation. Now, how we are going to, what we do and how we are going to remediate that at laboratory scale. So the oily sample has been taken, microbes has been isolated, and then the pot experiment has been performed. Different treatments has been added to this oily sludge. 60% of oily sludge was mixed with the controlled soil, and one treatment was uncontaminated or remained controlled, which is oily sludge. The second treatment was microbial consortium was prepared with Bacillus Pseudomonas exico orticum and Lysophorus Lysini Bacillus fusiforus, and then these microbes have been, this consortium has been prepared and then added, sprinkled over the soil surface and mixed thoroughly with hand to the soil in which we have added oily sludge, and then the nutrients were added in order to accelerate nitrogen and phosphorus concentration, because nitrogen and phosphorus are also playing very important role in providing the nutrient source for these microbes to degrade these hydrocarbon rapidly. So we wanting to know whether our consortium is suitable for degrading this hydrocarbon, how long will it take to degrade this hydrocarbon, and whether nitrogen and phosphorus fertilizer in combination or alone can enhance the degradation rate or not. So our hypothesis was that oily sludge is composed of C19 to C34 and alkane. Aromatic compounds were present in very minute quantity that cannot be calculated, and that's why I'm not showing you about the aromatic compounds. Only N alkanes were the focus, and also the isopropanoate was the focus of this degradation study. So we have seen that how long will it take for the total hydrocarbon to be degraded. We have seen here, this is the oily sludge which is in which we have not added any treatment. This is considered as a control. When consortium of these microbes were added or sprinkled over these, we have seen after 60 days, we see that the concentration of these alkanes has been reduced, and more or less 70 to 80% of degradation has been achieved from this consortium, and the lake phase has been reduced from to 60 days. But when we have used the same oily sludge with the fertilizer, only fertilizer consortium was not added, we can say that the time required for this fertilizer nutrients in order to indigenous microorganisms, that 240 days. And similarly, consortium with fertilizer is also not very effective. So our conclusion for this research work was that the consortium, when microbes added alone to the oily sludge, they can increase this rate of degradation. Then second thing, we know, we want to know what happened. Consortium addition is the inoculum that we are adding. There are some indigenous microbes which are already present in the soil, even in the oily sludge. They are inactive or inhibited. But when we are providing them additional substrate in the form of this consortium and fertilizer, then what will happen? These microbes are not going to live for 60 days, because what happens that the microbes are been eaten by other microbes, and then the biomass is created. That biomass become a substrate for other group of bacteria. And similarly, when we are seeing here the hydrocarbons which are degraded here, these hydrocarbons once degraded, if we are talking about NC10, then it is degraded into fatty acid and carbon dioxide and water. That fatty acid has become a source for other microorganisms, and then it provides a substrate. So the chain is continue and the activity is going on. It's not that we are going to add this consortium every day or every 5 days or every 10 days. We are just adding once in the beginning, and then we are going to see the effect slowly and gradually. Although we have not monitored that what happened to microbial biomass, because microbial biomass must have increased and they might have provided the substrate for these if the consortium activities has not been that affected. So it's all similarly, the hydrocarbon substrate are also the byproduct of these hydrocarbons may become a source for these microbes as a carbon and then carbon substrate, and then they multiply and they divide and they degrade these. That two aspects has not been studied. We're not the focus of our study, and all the most of the bioremediation studies are using this consortium. So what happened to the bacterial colony? Of course, sorry for this colony forming unit, because I have used the graph pad, and this is not 10,000. It is 2.2 × 10^4. 4, which are naturally present so microbial population is increasing with respect to time. When consortium was added, you can see here all this sludge plus consortium has increased the number of bacterial colony, and that bacteria increase in this bacteria shows us that the microbial life is active and they are degrading these hydrocarbon. So one of the indication what I have told you earlier about the microbial biomass and carbon substrate, it means that this carbon substrate is available for the microbes to continue their activity for degradation of these compounds. Now microbes is not only can be used, but when microbes react with plants, they are developing a very interesting interaction, and that's called rhizoremediation. Phytoremediation is only plants using plants only for degrading oily sludge hydrocarbon is really not successful. Phytoremediation techniques is successful for heavy metal for heavy metals contaminated soil, but it is not only recommended independently as bioremediation to remediate these. The reason for plants is that plant cannot survive under extreme environmental condition, which is oil contaminated soils, because lack of oxygen is present, plants cannot grow. But we did that. My other student Asim has done that. They have used maize and alfalfa plants. And for rhizoremediation technique, rhizoremediation means rhizosphere, and how rhizosphere can become active by using this that consortium or microbial anaclone. So different consortium has been used, and then the plants were grow in order to evaluate the effect of consortium plus fertilizer. Consortium plus plants. The two plants were used, alfalfa, we know that nitrogen symbiotic bacteria, and it had nodules on its roots, and it provide extra nutrient for the microbes. Maize, of course, is the fodder which can tolerate this extreme oil contamination. So that has been used, and the for rhizoremediation experiment, we have conducted a long-term experiment, but this is all laboratory experiment. So bacterial consortium is what's prepared from Bacillus cereus, Bacillus altitudinis, Bacillus commomonas, and Stentophomonas maltophilicia. We can see that what we have done, that separately or independently, these have been used. Untreated sludge, we can see that here is the colony forming unit in untreated sludge. The sludge with at 5 days was greater, and then at 10 days, the degradation was slow. And here, Bacillus independently, each strain was added, not the, only the consortium. Consortium was also prepared, but independent effect of these bacterial strain with fertilizer, with alpha-alpha was studies, and also with fertilizer plus alpha-alpha. So we come to know that one of the most important strain which is giving you giving us a most promising result is Bacillus altitudinis, and this Bacillus altitudinis with alpha alpha is giving us very good results of more than 80% of 70% of oily sludge or crude oil has been degraded. But remember that the concentration is low. We have used low concentration of oily sludge in order to understand. In the previous research paper, in the previous slide, we have used 60% of oily sludge mixed with soil, but here we use 20% of oily sludge with soil, and then these microbes were independently with alpha-alpha. Alpha-alpha was grown on the petri dish, and the seedling of alpha-alpha was grown on the pot in order to see whether they are survive or not. So they survive with this. Best survival of these alpha-alpha was obtained from Bacillus altitudinis. Now, what happened to the total petroleum hydrocarbon? Who is the most efficient? Although all of them are, but who is the most efficient among these four selected bacterial strain that can degrade the hydrocarbons rapidly? So we have found again Bacillus altitudinis is giving promising result, but all of them are can be used as a consortium because of their no negative or pathogenic effect on each other. Then what happened that we have used and treated these soil oily sludge with fertilizer, oily sludge with consortium, oily sludge plus consortium and fertilizer, oily sludge with alpha-alpha. Several treatments have been used, and we come to know that oily sludge plus alpha-alpha and consortium is giving us promising results even at 7 days of application. Some of these hydrocarbons has been degraded, and more than 40 to 50% of degradation has been achieved. Similarly, maize is also, but alpha-alpha has shown the most potential crop which can be used with oily sludge because of the presence of plant promoting rhizosphere bacteria compared to maize. These are some of the results that we have seen, and then we have prepared the consortium from these study, and this consortium is ready for commercialization and can be applied commercially to remediate larger surface larger scale of oil spills around the country. Asim Shahzad, who won the third innovation summit in 2014 with this project. And he has in biotechnology there are 500 posters, and he won the third prize in that 500 poster in biotechnology because of this innovation that he has done. And the patent has been also granted, national patent has been granted for this work. So lot of other work is also going on. Some of these research papers, if anyone interested can go through these research papers. So, am I fast or it's okay?
So it's good.
Yeah, we are fine.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes. So, I think it's a wonderful opportunity to look at the innovative techniques for bioremediation, and I think we have some time here for some questions and answers, and maybe. Samina, maybe I'll ask a question just quickly to get it started. I'm curious to know if your team is preparing some field experiments where you might move outside of the laboratory and try to conduct some bioremediation experiments in some of the oil fields.
Yes, actually, we have been asked by several companies to apply these, but they did not give us any response. And then we are in contact with the OGDCL to allow us to use their space for degradation study. But again, you know, my student had their PhD, they're gone. And then I am the only one. And if I have new fresh students, then I have to teach them. So I am very interested to use these commercial, these consortium and the plants outside the field in order to enhance the degradation of these at oily sludge site. Because one of the complaint we are receiving from Carl side that this oil has been spilled and they have they have spoiled their agriculture land, and and the company is paying several thousand penalty every year. See, when we are going to settle, hopefully shortly, I am planning this year in summer to do some field work with these techniques along with my students who are working now in different universities.
Yeah, good.
Yeah, I have a comment or a question. Dr. Samina, what do you think is the administration's response or the government's response as far as the, you know, these oil spillage and all these things are concerned? Because is there any regulatory control, any sort of thing?
No, Dr. Irfan, you know that there are legislation. Yeah. EPA has put the legislation, but to implement those legislation, there is no strategy. We can only submit up. We cannot, even if we are going to report this will not be taken any consideration from the policy makers, but it has to be a part of the
it's a very
complex issue, because
critical
for them. Yeah. For them, contaminated remediation of contaminated soil is not an important, but now, from now till the next decade, 2030, you will see there is no agricultural land will be remaining, as you see. These waste soils need to be remediated. And this is not only that the consortium that we have prepared is only for the oil contaminated soil. This can be replicated in drought resistant, because some of these species are, Pseudomonas protudia is the drought resistant species. This is from the salinity control species. Biofertilizers have not been used in KP, but biofertilizers are used around in Punjab area. But in KP, there are vast land in dry areas where we can use these microbes to grow those varieties which are drought resistant.
Well, what do you think? I mean, if I continue my question, what do you think are the challenges if you want to take your experimental model into the real world or the field? What are the challenges? Apart from funding, obviously,
There are several challenges, because you know the laboratory experiments are different than we are performing experiment in field.
Yeah.
First of all, that you have to get the permission from the owner of land. Maybe he would not like. It's their mindset. Second is that scientifically. We can do the surface remediation from this technique, surface. Spill. But if it is subsurface spill, then we have to have a long term, like plants, we have to use long rooted plants, that the roots of those plants has been penetrated deeper into the soil, so that they can remediate that that area. And we scientifically, everyone is looking for the time. Nobody wants to give you your field for 3-2 years for experimentation. They just want a rapid response from this. But anyway, we can try and we can
and there
do
is,
that.
And there is probably a conflict of interest, because obviously if you have leased out your field to a multinational company who are drilling there, who really cares about what's happening to the environment or what's going to be the scenario like after 10 years? whether those cells will be productive or not, fertile. It's really a very big issue because I can't imagine this problem, and it needs to be disseminated to the policymakers, to the government officials, so that something can come out of that. Yeah, I understand that.
Exactly.
Thank you. Yeah, we have a question from Gary Johnson. Gary, please. Yeah.
Hi, Professor. Please.
Gary, you have to unmute your...
I'm unmuted now. Okay. I have a question that's more, I suppose, academic than practical. I've wandered around in the Shugar range and the Shugar range in the trans noticed a number of natural oil seeps, some of which are quite extensive. And certainly many of the historic core oil fields were first recognized as potential because of natural oil seeps. Now, maybe this is the academic question, but these mature oil seeps, which have been going on for thousands of years, are being remediated in natural environments by naturally occurring study or a practicality at looking at some of these historic to see effectiveness of certain of the microbes in